great to be with you this morning, and we'd love to know that you've joined us this morning. In fact, would you just do something for us? We'd love to know that you're here by sending a message to us at mail@foresthomenaz.com. Let us know who's sitting there in your living room or wherever you're watching so that we can make contact with you later on during this week. And now let's join Pastor Aaron as he leads us this morning in worship.
Was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not
the weight of your glory.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy. The chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen.
Come on now.
When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a few. My eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name,
He called my name, and I raised out of that grave, and I came into his eternal day. Aren't you grateful for that? Hey, over the past year or so, we have been praying for a new shepherd, praying for our pastoral search. And this morning, we're going to be singing All the Way My Savior Leads Me. I wanted to read from Psalms 139. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. We're in a place as a church where we're looking, we're searching for God's will. And he's promised to be wherever we call to him, he will be there. Listen as Liz sings, all the way my Savior leads me. What have I to ask beside? Father, lead us this morning.
All the way my Savior leads me. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know whatever befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whatever befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know
trial, feed me with the living bread. Though my weary steps may falter, and my soul athirst may be, gushing from the rock before me, oh, a spring of joy I see, gushing from
this morning. He's promised he would, and we've seen it happen, and now we're praying that he's going to do it again.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall. for you have never failed me yet.
Your promise still stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet.
I know the night won't last.
Peace, peace, wonderful. coming down from the Father above. Sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows of love. What a treasure
Father, we come to you this morning thanking you for the peace that only you can give. Thanking you, Father, for the peace that in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of a pastoral search, in the midst of a tornado, in the midst of racial tensions, you can speak peace. It's a peace that we don't understand. The world doesn't understand it. But Lord, we know that it comes from you. And this morning, Father, we're thanking you for that peace that you've put in our hearts. This morning, Lord, I ask that you would be in all these situations that I've just mentioned. Be in our pastoral search. Thank you, Lord, for the great reports that we've had out of the meetings that have been happening in our board meetings recently. Thank you for the call you've placed on our candidates. And Lord, we're just asking you to continue in this process. Continue to be with Dr. Lindstrom as he leads the way. Continue to be with every board member. Give them your mind, Lord. Don't let them rely on their wisdom. But I pray, Lord, that you would give them a special touch, a special calling in their lives, that they would know without question the thing that you would have them to do. I ask, Lord, for our church. I ask, Lord, that you would be in our ministries during this difficult time. Lord, help this to be a time that we rise up, that we meet people's needs with you. Help us not to try to meet those needs with our own resources. But Lord, we know that you've made a way. You've promised you have, and we believe that. Father, I pray you'd be in this service. Be with Dr. Reeder as he speaks to us. Give him your words, I pray. I pray, Father, that those words would cut through all of the stuff that we've brought with us this morning. And may we walk out of this place today with more peace and with a better determination to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good to be with you online today, and I just want to remind you that if you go to the YouVersion Bible app in your phone, you can get the notes that are there for this message today. I like the story of a Bible college student who was taking a sermon writing class, and he passed his paper into the professor, and the professor gave it right back to him and said, "This is a terrible title. You need to have a title that is so compelling that if a person's on a bus riding past the church and they see the title on the marquee sign of the board, that they'll demand that the bus be stopped and they'll run into the church. And the seminary student thought about it for a moment and wrote a new title out, which said, "There's a bomb on your bus." A bomb on bus is not what Bob, the title of this message, stands for. Bob stands for a best of the best practice. And the best of the best practice for the Christian is having a spirit of thanksgiving. You might say, "But Pastor, this is a fallen world, and I'm experiencing pain and brokenness. How can I have a spirit of thanksgiving in a time like this?" And I would say to you, there's a great truth that helped me understand the working of the Lord a little bit better. And the truth is this, that new life only emerges in the dark times. And Voskamp writes, "From the seed in the ground to the resurrection from the tomb, new life only emerges from darkness." So brothers and sisters, the darker the time, we know the closer we are to new life emerging. Let's look at how this works in Scripture. Three different models. The first one is this. It's Jehoshaphat. And if you turn in your Bibles to 2 Chronicles chapter 20, we're going to start at verse 20. The background is Jehoshaphat's the king of Judah. And there's these three armies that have all united together from three different nations, each nation stronger and bigger than the nation of Israel, but the three of them together make an insurmountable force. It's certain doom for Jehoshaphat and the people of Judah. And so what's Judah do about it? How does he confront this army? Verse 20 of 2 Chronicles 20 says, "Early in the morning, they left for the desert of Tekoa." They're going to face this army. "As they set out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, 'Listen to me, Judah and people of Jerusalem. Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful.' After consulting with the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him for the splendor of his holiness as they went out at the head of the army, saying, 'Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever.'" Now pay close attention, verse 22. "As they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir who were invading Judah, and they were defeated." The most oft-repeated phrase in all of Scripture is located right here. "Give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever." When we'll engage in the most oft-repeated message of Scripture, the mighty warriors of thanksgiving will bring down whatever barrier stands before us. Jehoshaphat, 2 Chronicles 20:20. Let's look at the second model, Joshua, chapters 6, verse 6. And so turn with me in your Scripture to Joshua, and the background is, they've just crossed the Jordan. They've just gone through a time of great pain. And if you look at chapter 5, I'm not going to get into it here in the message, but you'll see what that pain is about. And they've just healed up from that pain, and now they're faced with the greatest nation on the face of the earth, the oldest city in the history of civilization, with impregnable defenses in their walls, and the strongest army. And here's Israel with no warfare experience, really no weaponry, faced with this great obstacle. And we pick up at verse 1 of chapter 6. Now Jericho was tightly shut up. because of the Israelites, no one went out and no one came in. Then the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have delivered Jericho into your hands, along with its king and its fighting men. March around the city once with all the armed men. Do this for 6 days. Have 7 priests carry trumpets of ram's horns in the front of the ark. On the 7th day, march around the city 7 times with the priests blowing the trumpets. When you hear them sound a long blast on the trumpets, have all the people give a loud shout. Then the wall of the city will collapse and the people will go up, every man straight in." Let's skip to verse 16. The 7th time around, when the priests sounded the trumpet blast, Joshua commanded the people, "Shout, for the Lord has given you the city." And at that shout of thanksgiving, those walls that had stood for thousands of years, that had never been defeated, fell in the face of the overwhelming force of thanksgiving. Let's look at the third model. It's Jesus. And we're picking up in Jesus' life in Matthew 26, chapter 26, and verse 26. I like the way these references line up. Jehoshaphat, 2 Chronicles 20:20, Joshua, Joshua 6:6, and Jesus, Matthew 26:26. I can remember that. And this is a very serious time in Jesus' life. It's really the darkest hour of his life. He knows that his hour has come. The cross is upon him. He's going to endure great pain and suffering and sorrow, because one of the 12, in just the preceding verse, Jesus has revealed that he knows that Judas is about to forsake him. So he's been forsaken and he faces the greatest hour of his difficulty. And verse 26 picks up in that context. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." You see, Jesus understood that this bread represented his broken body. It was the bread of his own affliction. And even knowing all of that, in this dark hour, he pauses and thanks the Father for this bread of affliction. And in the act of giving thanks, God's Spirit comes upon him, and he's able, even in that time of great need, to break that bread and as a blessing give it to his disciples, even the one who betrayed him. The Greek for the Lord's Supper is Eucharistio, which literally means give thanks. And embedded in Eucharistio is the Greek word charis, which means grace, and chara, which means joy. You see, grace and joy, in your notes, come in giving thanks and empower us, even in our darkest hour of affliction, to give unto others. That, I believe, is the greatest recognizable attribute of Jesus. When we, in our own affliction, will pause and give thanks and be empowered by the Holy Spirit then to give to others, that will show a hungry world the truth of Jesus. We see this illustrated on the road to Emmaus. It's two disciples that are walking along, and it's the very day that they hear that Jesus has been raised from the dead. The three women came back with the report, and then some of the disciples ran to the tomb and saw, yes, it is empty. And these two disciples on this road to Emmaus in Luke chapter 24 heard all of this. But yet they're walking along the road, and the spirit and the scripture says, and they had a downcast faces. And so this is how they were walking along the road on the very day they'd heard Jesus had been raised from the dead. There they were. They were hunched over, and their faces were looking down, and they were discouraged, and they were moping along and kind of going along like this. And suddenly, Jesus appears. And you'd think they would have recognized. They'd heard that he was alive. They'd think they might have wondered, who's this person that, poof, is along beside us? But they didn't. And then Jesus sees their downcast faces, and he begins to scold them. And you'd think they would have recognized that scolding. I mean, he'd scolded them many times before, but no, they didn't recognize the scolding. And then he begins to teach them. And you'd think they would have recognized the teaching. I mean, who can teach like that, starting at the beginning of the book of Genesis and working through all the law and the prophets? But they still didn't recognize him from the teaching. And nightfall came, and they said to this stranger, it was Jesus, they said to that stranger, come and stay with us. It's late at night. Don't continue to travel on. And so they got into the home where they were staying. And this is where the scripture picks up in verse 30 of Luke 24. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him. See, this is the most recognizable attribute of Jesus. A spirit of thanksgiving that breaks the bread, even the bread of his afflictions, and gives it as a blessing to others, and their eyes were opened. The attribute of taking the bread of affliction, giving thanks, and giving it to others is the core recognizable attribute of Jesus. And when we'll do that, brothers and sisters, in this broken world, I believe they too will see Jesus. I mean, who does that? Let's apply this today. You know, the world has become a believer in thanksgivers. And there's been a lot of clinical research done on this, and it's been discovered that people who are thanksgivers have less stress and anxiety. They are more effective in reaching their goals. They have deeper, fuller, more satisfying relationships. Now this is starting to sound like eHarmony. They are 25% happier than those who are non-thanksgivers. The truth is, it's not happy people who are thankful. It's thankful people who are happy. You see, through thanksgiving, we invite the Lord's presence, his light, into the very darkness, into our darkness. And we become then bread that can be given to a hungering world. Bread that's grace and love and joy and peace. Well, how do we embed this thanksgiving habit in our lives? Well, we're going to do a little experiment of our own. I'm going to ask you just in a few moments when we close in prayer to pause and thank the Lord for three things right now. But the greatest challenge I'm going to give you today is to start a habit. And my wife and I, Janet, we call this our thankful three. And every night when it's time for us to go to sleep, as we lay in our beds, the last thing we do is we share our thankful three with each other. We review the day in our own hearts and minds. Think of all the wonderful gifts from the Father that we've received that day. We prioritize it into our top three and we share our thankful three with one another. And as the last words we speak, we go to sleep. You don't have to be married to do this. You can get a Thanksgiving partner and text each other back and forth, or set a time during the day when you connect and say, what's your thankful three today? What's your thankful three? Maybe you want to do it with the kids if you've got a family, and ingrain this habit into their young hearts and minds of being thanksgivers. However you do it, maybe you'll just end up doing it all on your own, but I encourage you to get somebody to be accountable with. However you do it, would you start that habit of being a thanksgiver and embed it every single day? Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Father, we want to start by pausing, recognizing that every good and perfect gift comes from you. And Lord, we're just going to pause, and every one of us in these quiet moments are going to review your many blessings and thank you for three of them. And Lord, would you help us take this next step? Would you so impress upon us from your word the importance of thanksgiving that we would start a habit of being thanksgivers, that folks in the church would even start this thankful three pattern and give you praise and thanksgiving, especially in the darkest times, that new life would emerge. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Pastor Aaron, come and lead us with the worship team on a song of praise and thanksgiving as we come before the Lord, going our separate ways, but one in Jesus.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. When darkness seems to hide its face,
Christ the Lone Cornerstone.
Christ the Lone Cornerstone. Weak made strong in the Savior's blood. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Shall come with trumpet sound. If you haven't been here the last couple of weeks, let me introduce myself. I'm Mona Baker. I am the Sunday School and Discipleship Ministries Chair here at Forest Home. And I bring greetings from our church board this morning with some wonderful news. The church board has come to a decision that we would like to interview one of our candidates in person in the very near future. So our wish this morning is that you will pray for traveling mercies for this candidate, and that you will pray for discernment for the board, that we will do all things according to God's will for His honor and glory.
Well, we have some news, and that's exciting that we can continue to be praying for whatever it is that God has as we continue to go through this process. Thank you, Forest Home family, for joining us in worship this morning. We're continuing to give thanks for the way that God is continuing to work through you as we go through this pandemic and everything together. Thank you for your continued giving and the way you have supported Forest Home Church of the Nazarene. As we think towards next week and whatever God has in store for us in that, we are excited to tell you that we have an opportunity for everyone. We have two services that we'll be having, one at 9 and the other at 10:30. The 9 o'clock service will be for those who are wearing masks from the moment they come in the building until they leave. If that's you, we'd love to have you call and give a reservation for that service. Be sure you do that before 5 o'clock on Thursday so we can make sure we have chairs set up appropriately for everyone. The others will come at 10:30, and that will be for those who feel comfortable socially distanced to take their masks off when they're seated. We look forward to seeing everyone and continuing to worship together as we do so here at Forest Home. Thanks again for joining us this morning.